It color changes when your hands are warm.
This does?
Uh-huh. I got one last time we were here. Your hands are really warm.
My hands are pretty warm. Yeah. I was thinking it would be good to keep it circled for Joshua.
Thank you. let it, no, you don't really want to let it. I mean, I was trying to, I'm like, I was. So that would be the only.
No, like, at least reviewing it, if you, you know, we got it from there. She does one sample.
She's so sweet. I was just, I was shocked. So my brother was about to go to the party, and I was, she was awesome.
All right, check one.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
No. He's going to pull you. What's that? Oh, you took Joel's place?
I took Morgan's. I'm Morgan.
Right. Thank you.
Audio check.
Welcome. Welcome, everyone. What a beautiful morning. We're so glad to see you at our 9th annual conference. And I really would like to welcome you on behalf of the Kent ISD and our sponsors to the Lead, Empower, Assist Parents Conference. My name is Barbara Corbin. I'm the Early On Coordinator here at the ISD, and I'm going to do a few announcements, and then we're going to begin with our speaker. You have in your bag this green guide that will tell you everything you need to know. It has the schedule at a glance on it. It has a map, and at registration, they probably told you if your room is full, you may choose another one. So we have some of the popular sessions repeated in the afternoon, so you may want to check that out as you get going. We also have all the handouts that we have so far from the presenters are posted on the website, and that address should be in your program as well. And if they are not posted yet, they will be posted by Monday. So if you want handouts from a session you weren't able to attend, you should be able to download those, okay? So we have 16 exhibitors today. Please visit them all. Some of them have individual drawings at their station. The Zorby lady is the woman that has the big chairs right when you walk in by the coffee. And they are raffling at their station a giant orange bean bag. And so you definitely want to stop by there. That drawing is going to take place at noon. So make sure on a break that you go visit the Zorby lady. And if you want a giant orange bean bag in your house, which many people do. We have over 100 prizes donated by local businesses and all of our exhibitors here. And so the way that we do the prizes is if you are registered, we put a copy of your name tag into our pink bucket, and we will pull them out throughout the day. So where you registered becomes our information table, and you're just going to want to check there throughout the day to see if you won an awesome prize. Lunch will be provided at 11:35 in the room where you had breakfast. And we have two overflow rooms across from this room if you're looking for seating at lunchtime. I want to thank all our staff and volunteers and presenters, exhibitors for their time and talent today. And thanks especially to our generous sponsors, Family Tree Therapies, Calvin College Rehabilitation Services, the Kent County Health Department, Comprehensive Therapy, Brains, and the Family Hope Foundation are our sponsors. So stop by their tables and thank them when you have a chance. I'm so pleased that my friend Janice came today. let me tell you a little bit about her. Janice Fialka is a nationally recognized speaker, author, and social worker with an expertise in adolescent health, parent-professional partnerships, inclusion, and post-secondary education for students with intellectual disabilities. She has co-founded and directed several teen health centers in Michigan and has previously taught at Wayne State University in the School of Social Work. She is a special projects trainer for Michigan's Early On Training and Technical Assistance. Over the past two decades, Janice has provided the keynote address and conducted workshops at numerous national and international conferences for audiences of families, school personnel, educators, social workers, early interventionists, healthcare providers, and community groups. Janice has received several awards for her advocacy work, including the 2007 Social Worker of the Year by the National Association of Social Workers of Michigan chapter. Janice and her husband Rich Feldman co-produced the award-winning DVD Through the Same Door. Inclusion Includes College, which was awarded the 2006 TASH Image Award for the positive portrayals of people with disabilities. This film documents Micah, their son's, experience as a college student. Micah, a rising leader in the disability movement, is a part of a new wave of young adults with intellectual disabilities who continue their learning on a university campus. Janice has co-authored three books, numerous articles. I know, she says stop, but I'm just going to do them one more paragraph. And a CD of her poems entitled From Puddles to Pride, which includes her often published poem, Advice to Professionals Who Must Conference Cases. These books and CDs are on display and for sale at Rich, it has a table. We also have 10 signed books that we're going to be raffling off from Janice. Her website, thedanceofpartnership.com, is a highly regarded comprehensive resource for parents and professionals. This information is also included on your program. In 2009, Janice and her family received the Family Voices Lifetime Achievement Award in Washington, D.C., for their work in advocacy and disability. Okay, I'm done. Awesome, awesome. So I'm so happy Janice and Rich were able to join us today, and please welcome Janice Fialka.
Barbara is still up here. You have a gem in this community. Barbara Corbin understands what partnership is about. She understands what big dreams are about, high expectations. So let's applaud her and her staff. Thank you. So even, Barbara, so you know I even put this. Thank you to Barbara Corbin, Kent, Aya, Steve, funders, and all the families who really made this day and many days happen. We really appreciate that. So. All right, I'm going to have to refer to my notes because I have to be very concise. We have about 35 minutes together. So I'm really pleased to be here. So I'm going to say, so I can hear you, good morning, and please return that. Thank you. I love to hear your voice. So this is quite an event, and one of the things that I'm aware of is that everybody in this room and in other rooms, hello to all of you wherever you are sitting, you're working to create a life or lives that matter. And the one way that we do that, there are many ways, but one way we do that is by sharing and telling our stories. And so Barbara was creative in her staff. In your bag is a red squeezy heart that you can squeeze when you need a moment of releasing tension. But it also says sharing stories support our heart. So I will be telling you basically two stories about our family during this morning time with you as well. I know that I would not be standing here today if I hadn't attended conferences, workshops, gatherings with other families and professionals, but primarily other families. I remember that one of the first workshops that my husband Rich and I attended, there were 1,000 parents there. And I looked in their eyes, I listened to their stories of terror and triumph, and all of a sudden I felt like I was home, I belonged, they understood me. So that sense of being connected to others is really important. So your stories matter. So as you share your stories about your family or your students, if you're a professional, do it with dignity and pride and lean into each other's stories as well. Stories remind us that that we are not alone. That's really important. Sometimes we're the teller and sometimes we're in the audience. Stories help us build connections. One of my new favorite quotes is, words are how we think. You know, we get ideas from words, we get new strategies, new resources. But stories are how we link, how we connect with others. So one of the things I think my husband and I learned early is to tell stories about our son and his community. That was a big sort of leap for me because I was raised, you know, not to be boastful, don't talk too much about yourself. But what I learned is that by me sharing things about our son, it had that ripple effect. So I just want to encourage you to tell your stories. Stories also give us courage. Maybe not that kind of courage that roars, you know. Although I'm sure there were times when I've been called a roaring lioness mother in some of those meetings. But sometimes courage is that quiet voice at the end of the day that says, I will try again tomorrow. And that's what we do. We maybe have a sleepless night, but we decide that we're going to do it again, try it again tomorrow. So my husband and I have two children. My son, Rich, is in the back. You're going to meet him. He's probably already attacked you with one of our postcards from our book. Micah, our son, is 32 years old and has an intellectual disability, is also has a very rich life, in part because of the opportunities that he's had. And I won't be able to go into all of that, but we'll be doing more at our workshop after lunch around Circle of Friends. Our daughter, Emma, is a second grade teacher and does full inclusion as well. So there's also a fifth member of our family. We don't have dogs, cats, pets, but Emma's holding it here. It's ice cream. It is definitely a member of our family. We need it. So I'm sure everybody in this room here deals with labels. Either you're the receiver of labels or you give them out. I want to share probably our family's favorite label for Micah is a political junkie. He knows a lot about current events. He stays in touch with what's happening in the news if you Facebook him as a friend, and he will ask us, did you tell everybody to friend me, Mom? Now, to give you a sense of how loyal he is to current events, when he was in sixth grade for Halloween, he dressed up as Bill Clinton. That was his commitment. But there are many other labels that Micah received, and even when I look at this picture, and he gave us permission to use this, you know, I remember, it's hard to, this child who did not look so healthy and was fragile and we had no idea what his life would be like. That first label plastered on his head was failure to thrive. And as I said, he did give me permission to use this as long as I put that up, the sign up there as well. But he's been bombarded, if you will, with so many labels. You can see a few of them coming up now. Sensory integration disorder, visual motor delay, Ritalin, educable mentally impaired, trainable mentally impaired, intellectual disability, low IQ. 2 years ago he had an ascending aorta aneurysm. So there's all these labels that, in a sense, take away my child. I can't see him or know the child that I loved and I bore. So a part of our work as families and providers is to reclaim our child and to change that story from something that seems impossible or difficult to one of hope and possibility as well. So eventually Micah did get those chubby cheeks, but he has carried in some ways those labels with him. and given many more to himself. So one of the things that we have to do in terms of our stories is move from what can't be to what can be. And how do we frame it? So I could tell you that Micah does not read or write in the traditional sense. He does speak, but he doesn't read or write in the traditional sense. He uses technology. So depending on how I frame that, I have a whole different feel for him. So I want to always, when it comes to Micah, refer to what he can do with supports. That's a way to frame the story for me. And that's something that I had to learn. I've been at this for 32 years. I did not come out knowing this stuff. It's been a journey of stumbling quite a bit. So Barbara mentioned we have a new book out that chronicles Micah's life over the last 32 years, so just wanted to make note of that. My husband Rich loves talking with people, and he's a very good listener. I've trained him well, and so he will be selling the books as well. So I just wanted to mention that. So the first story that I want to share occurred when Micah was in high school, and he was one of the first students to be fully included. Let me just skip to my notes to make sure I stay on topic here. He was one of the first students to be included in high school, and so we were looking for how do we make sure that he has connections with people, with his peers. And we found a young man, JJ, who was a junior in high school, who was needed to do community service. And so Micah, in a sense, became the person that he fulfilled his community service project with. Now, that wasn't always easy, I'll be honest with you, to think of Micah in that way. But one of the things that I've learned is to be humbled and to realize that there's many ways to establish connections with Micah's peers. And one of the things that we found is that many people will be friendly to Micah, but not necessarily be his friends, right? And so we as family members and as community have to really nudge those relationships. Not all of them will end up being friends, but eventually you find ways that there are genuine friendships. So we talked with JJ and we said, hey JJ, how do we help Micah be connected to his peers? And JJ said, oh, that's easy. Have him go out for a cross-country team. Because you don't have to try out, you just have to show up. So we thought that was a great idea. Yay, Micah will go after school, he'll get physically active. Now, we forgot to consult Micah, who said, Mom, I don't even like to walk around the block, you want me to run? But, you know, we used that fifth member of our family and we bribed him with lots of ice cream and we said, would you just try it for 4 weeks? So indeed, he was willing to do that, and JJ sort of helped that a little bit. So after a few weeks, we got a phone call from the coach, and he said, would you be willing to meet with us? And we said, of course. But we knew what was going to happen. He was going to say, you know, we've gotten to know Micah, he's a nice kid, he's got a great smile, but he's really not cross-country material. So we went to the meeting, you know, getting ready, bracing ourselves, sat down, shook his hand, said hello, and he said, I'm getting to know Micah, you know, and my heart is sinking. And then he says, I have a goal for Micah. A goal, we thought? You're not going to kick him off the team? He said, I think if we work hard with Micah that he will be able to run 1 mile in one of the meets. So we left that meeting feeling quite different than from the way that we started that meeting. And indeed, on a beautiful fall day in Michigan, you know, where the sky's blue and the leaves are all those wonderful different colors, Micah ran 1 mile in 11 minutes and 32 seconds, which is the exact amount of time that I cried as well during that time, right? So there's many more stories, and if you pick up the book and you read, you'll hear more stories about that, this cross-country experience. But I want to share with you one more chapter of it. Several years later, we went to, we were shopping at a store, and we ran into this coach that had a goal for Micah. And we chatted, and I said, you know, Micah still is sort of running, you know, on a somewhat regular basis. And we thanked him and, you know, talked about school. And then there was that moment, you know, his eyes got a little bit teary, and we weren't sure what was going to happen. And he leaned in and he said, I want you to know that our daughter eventually ended up with labels and needed an IEP, an individual educational plan. And every meeting when I would go in, we would channel, if you will, your husband and you, and I felt less alone. So, of course, we cried again. That's what mothers do. And so there's so many lessons in that story as well. We just never know how our lives will ripple into others' lives. And so I just want to mention a couple of the lessons that I want to remind you of, or remind me of, really, because I'm always learning these. And that first lesson is that we have to learn how to ask for help or invite support with dignity, grace, and intention, not with apology. To be able to say to JJ, can you help me figure out how to do this? All right? So this is something that I think has been important for our family to learn. The second one is to value interdependency. We launched our book on July 4th, and we named it as if we had authority. We named that day not Independence Day, because none of us are independent. None of us do this alone. We launched it, and we refer to July 4th now as Interdependence Day as well. And so this photo I just love, because this clearly shows a sense of being a part of something, using imagination, and everybody's engaged in that as well. Even the folks that are further back, they're important to cheering this on as well. Does that make sense? All right, the other one is to dream big. We're not always able to arrive at our dream, but if we don't have the dreams, we don't have that energy that kickstarts us and move us further along. I'll tell you very honestly that when Michael was first, when we were first learning to be his parents, and we learned that he had all these labels attached to him, we stopped dreaming for Micah. Not easy to say, but it's a true reality for us. And we were fortunate enough to meet a woman, Marcia Forrest, who is a real pioneer in inclusion. And she noticed that we had really sort of pulled inward. And she was a sassy woman and made a lot of important changes, and she sort of lectured us. And she reminded us that many years ago, as all of you know, Martin Luther King stood in front of that giant audience of people and shouted what we've all heard over and over again, I have a dream, right? And I wondered where she was going in this lecture. And she said to us, he didn't stand in front of that audience with that wonderful booming voice of dignity and perseverance and say, I have goals and objectives. It's a very different feel. And so although we need those goals and objectives, and thank you to the providers here who spend a lot of time finding the right words to give to parents, but it's really the dreams that fuel us, that allow us to move forward. I found this quote, if your dreams do not scare you, they're not big enough. Okay. Without dreams, the new is never invented. That coach with a goal reimagined the 5K cross-country trail, which is 3 miles, and modified or adapted it so that Micah could have, and his mother and father could have, a dream of running in the cross-country team. So Micah's dream, as many of you have heard, if you've heard Micah's story, is in first grade. He was in a self-contained classroom, great teacher, lots of good energy going on, but Micah's dream was, I want to go in the same door as all my other friends. And so, as you will learn, or maybe you already know, we've followed him through those same doors as well over his life. Another lesson I want to offer is that we need to see disability not as a deficiency, but as a difference. So if you look here, Micah's dream was to go to the prom, and it took some work to make that happen. You will, if you could, count. There are 8 couples and 1 young man. For me, the mom, what I saw was the deficiency, if you will. Ah, he doesn't have a date. For Micah, it was just a difference. He was totally happy to be with his friends, to be in a limousine that had a fake fireplace in it, and to dress up in a tuxedo. So that is one of the lessons. And then also the lesson that our children need lots of opportunities. So I'm going to move along. So I want to talk a little bit. So that's story number one and some of the lessons. The second story that I want to tell is a very tender story in our family's life. It's about a friendship between Micah and Scott. So when Micah was 17, we went to the Inclusion Institute in Toronto, which is a gathering of families, providers, community people from really all over the world. And Micah was interested in coming because he knew some of the organizers. So when we arrived there, Micah looked around and he saw all kinds of adults. And then he wondered, why am I here? And then he was able to find someone who looked around his age. So Scott and his 3 personal assistants became Micah's good friends. And thank goodness, because they hung out together, they went to the park, they went to a few of the workshops, but mainly they were they enjoyed each other. And this is a 4-day event, so they got to know each other fairly well. So on the last day of the event, it's a very moving ceremony, and everybody gets around and talks about, really, they tell stories. What impact did being with this group have? What did they learn? So there's a lot of tears. And also a lot of laughter. Now, at this gathering, the last day gathering, Scott's mother, Gloria, came. And this had been a milestone for Scott because he was not with his family, his mother and father. He was able to be at the Institute with his personal assistants. So Gloria and I were sitting next to each other, really enjoying this friendship that Micah and Scott had created. And we were once again crying, as Micah would say, that's what mothers do. And Gloria turned to me and said, this is such a big day in Scott's life. I feel like he became a man. And Micah overheard that comment and said, well, if he became a man, then he needs to have a bar mitzvah. Because that's what in the Jewish tradition, when you turn 13 and become a man, you have a bar mitzvah, a ceremony. So Gloria smiled at Micah and said, yeah, thank you, but we're Catholic. And Micah's elegant response was, so? Micah persisted and said, we're going to Israel in a few weeks, and when we go there, we will purchase a prayer shawl, which, I'll show you in a second. So we did find a prayer shawl, and Micah brought it back and then took it to Scott's house. Scott lived in Canada about 3 miles away. Three hours away. And so he would hang out with Scott. He took him the prayer shawl, which was very similar to this one. It was a beautiful, very colorful piece of clothing that someone would wear during the bar mitzvah. So Micah persisted. Let's see, we go till 20. Okay. All right, so if I go till 22?
You're good.
Okay, all right. So Micah persisted and continued to talk to Gloria and Peter about having a bar mitzvah. And I'm going to shift gears here just for a quick second, because one of the things that happened was that Gloria and Peter really, in many ways, became our mentors. they worked incredibly hard to make sure that Scott was fully included in his community. It didn't always happen, but it happened enough so that he was, in fact, engaged. And so I want to share with you, thanks to the help of Ron, our AV man here, just about a minute of this video. So you see that Scott and his friends were intentionally connected. Let's see, now I hit this one. No, did it wrong. Yeah, coming, okay. So just watch Scott in his community.
For all those times you stood by me, for all the truth that you made me see, for all the joy you brought to my life, for all the wrong that you made right.
It says many things. He's connected. It takes intention to make that happen. The world would often see Scott as a can't kid. He couldn't walk on his own. He couldn't communicate in a fashion that many of us do. He didn't hear. He didn't see. And yet he had a place, an important place in the world. So back to Micah. Eventually, Gloria and Peter succumbed to Micah's persistence. And they had a Catholic bar mitzvah. I mean, he brought his video of his bar mitzvah so they could see how you do it. He even brought his invitation and said, all you have to do is cross out Micah and put in Scott. So we gathered, there were about 125 people who gathered to tell stories. And Richie got to be rabbi for the day. His mother was very proud, my husband. And so one of the things that did occur is that the bus driver who hung out with Scott on Saturdays met the teenager who helped Scott learn how to swim. And all these different connections and that community of people really got to see that it does take a village, if you will, to, I don't know, to raise Scott. In many ways, I think our daughter Emma would often say that you need a Micah to raise a village. You need a child to raise a village in many ways. So let's see. This is Scott with his two sisters and his father, Peter. And at the end of this Catholic bar mitzvah, Peter, Scott's father, called out, "It's all Micah's fault." So I want to share the final story of Scott, and there's a tenderness to this, so I want you to be aware of that. So about 8 months, 9 months later, we got a phone call from Gloria saying that Scott was very sick and probably would die by the end of the week. And it just so happened that Mike and I, received the phone call of Scott's passing when we were here in Grand Rapids doing a workshop many years ago. So there's a real fragility to the storytelling for me. And Micah said to me, I have to be with my friend Scott. It will be the last time. So we drove 6 hours, I remember, in the rain, and we arrived at Scott's house about 1 a.m. And Gloria had she learned how to be able to keep Scott's body at home because she wanted that intimacy of visitors in their home. And so when we arrived, I remember that there was someone playing Amazing Grace on the piano. Peter and Gloria pointed to Scott's room. Micah knew where it was. And he walked in, and there was little Scott, whose body probably only weighed about 70 pounds then, in his bed with the prayer shawl around him. And Micah got in bed and put his arm around his friend Scott and told stories of what his life had been because of Scott. And the next day, when Gloria and Peter were tenderly carrying their son, putting him in the casket, Micah stood by because Gloria wanted all the petals from all the flowers in the casket. And Micah decided that he wanted no flowers by his face. He says, boys don't want flowers. So then, we leave for the church, the Catholic Church, and as we're, streaming into the church with all these people, everybody knew Micah, and everybody thanked him for bringing people together for that very famous Catholic bar mitzvah, right? All right, so the last moment in this chapter right now is when the priest came out, and the casket was rolled down the aisle, and he was carrying the prayer shawl, and he put it over the casket, and he said, this belongs here, because all religions are about love and inclusion. So I share that with you. Scott is continuing to have an impact because of his life and the way his family was willing to connect people. So, some of the takeaways that I hope you leave with is that to see disability as a difference, to value interdependency, to build those circles, to break the silence, create opportunities, drop the labels, and be persistent about the dreams. Would you join me in reading this last quote together? So, 1, 2, 3. As we start to really get to know others, as we begin to listen to each other's stories, things begin to change. We begin the movement from exclusion to inclusion, from fear to trust, from closeness to openness, from judgment to forgiveness, from prejudice to understanding. It is a movement of the hearts. One last time, the last line. It is a movement of the hearts. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Janice. That was lovely. Thank you. So you can move to your next, your first session, and enjoy the day.
And tell your
stories. And tell your stories.
Okay. don't want to go into labor in here.
We don't want that either, so. Because the last time that happened, I was in the Air Force about 20 years ago and actually helped deliver. I don't want to do that.
So you've got experience.
I'm not good at that. It's not one of my core competencies. Laptops that decided they were going to be laptops again. Didn't want to do upgrades.